final pieces of mourning before we turn east and pray up?
The mourning that I am going to lose, Lord. I am going to leave my house alone. I am mourning my fear. Because if I let my fear consume me, I won't be on this island.
I want us to take all that we're mourning. All that was even able to be said that we're mourning. All the confessions that we brought into this space. And by your turn east. East is the direction. To the heavens are essential to our prayers. When you hear the sound of the shofar, don't hold back. Cry out with everything that you have.
My name Yehudah means praise HaShem, give thanks to the Most High. I'm a community organizer with Jews for Racial and Economic Justice, where we work alongside other grassroots organizations to fight for New York, where we all have the resources and the ability to thrive in this city. I work and staff the campaign that's reducing the size, scope, and power of the NYPD to bring that back into balance with the other social services that actually ensure public safety for all of us.
After George Floyd was murdered, and honestly, what happened to Christian Cooper in Central Park?
There is an African-American man. I am in Central Park. He is recording me and threatening myself and my dog. I'm being threatened by a man into the ramble. Please send the cops immediately.
That's actually what broke me open. After all these decades of organizing and protesting and policy and lobbying, we still not more valued than a dog? How much progress can we even claim? I carved out time to study with my Abba and Ima. We were really grappling with, why is this still happening? Why are we in this never-ending cycle of oppression? And what, on a spiritual level, are we called to do to wake up not just our communities, but to also wake up HaShem?
Is because of what happened with the destruction of the first temple, we've never been the same as a people. There's been an exile, we were exiled, and the only way we can have justice is if we first understand the causes of the exile, which is internal, spiritual, our transgressions from Hashem. And if we don't correct those faults, we're never going to get the justice we seek. We have to turn back to Hashem. We have to make the Teshuvah.
It's very important to have that relationship with the Creator.
You feel like you're accountable to something much greater than yourself.
Right.
I've grown up my whole life, my parents continue to live by this value of when you're at a loss of what to do physically, turn to the spiritual, turn to Torah. What would our ancestors do? In our study, one of the pieces that we kept coming back to was the way in which our ancestors used to mourn. And one of those spiritual tools at their disposal was the shofar. a tool to call our communities to action, used for celebration, to signal war, to mark holidays. It was used so often that the prophet Yirmiyahu, on the cusp of the destruction of the first temple and before going into exile, warned our ancestors that one of the things we'd hear no more is the sound of the shofar. To not hear it on a regular basis is to be in disconnection from the heavens and HaShem.
It was Sunday, June 21st, and I had this thought of taking these different texts. What would it look like to do a daily action? Leading into Tisha B'Av, where we mourn every year the destruction of the temple and our exile from the land. It then dawned on me, I said, oh, whoa, how many days is this? I just like quickly counted and I was like, it's 40 days. That's a spiritual significant number. 40 days was Moshe on Mount Sinai. 40 days were the spies in the land of Israel. 40, 40, 40. And I felt called to do this for 40 days and to invite others in the community to join me. And it started with just 5 of us.
Welcome to 40 days of Teshuvah. 40 days of return. We're bringing the physical fight for racial justice to meet the spiritual, creating a space of mourning. I want to invite folks who are just arriving to find a sign. Sign of demand or of confessions.
And I invite others to step into the circle and add their voices to what we were collectively mourning.
Would not she tell me at that time the different things that they could have done so that I did not have to have surgery? What are they doing to us? Is this government trying to kill black women?
The structure of 40 Days of Teshuvah was really modeled off of some of the key components of Teshuvah that we find in Torah. Number one, vidui and confession, really acknowledging the ways in which we've missed the mark.
In my past, I also used the N-words in casual circumstance. I did not check other people around me who used that word.
I did not speak up when I recognized.
And number two, commitment and accountability, speaking to the ways in which we're going to do things differently the next time around. Grounding our commitments, the highest accountability.
And when you hear the sound of the shofar, the spiritual tool that establishes a direct line to Hashem in the heavens, lift up your voice, cry out with all that you've got.
We'd invite folks to share the changes that they're committing to make in their lives.
And I'm realizing that tackling anti-blackness in my life has to be a second by second, minute, hour, every day for the rest of my life thing.
Thank you for being out here. We'll be out here through July 30th, Tisha B'Av. See y'all tomorrow.
I haven't, as a black man, been allowed to be in my body and feel the rage and the grief. And both as a man and as a black person, right? Those are things that society has not allowed, that white supremacy and racism has shut down.
I mean, how painful was it for me, right, to have to teach Yehudah as a son? Look, when you get pulled over, make sure you put the two hands on the steering wheel and make sure you don't make any sudden moves.
by design, the space is for Black people in the sense that we're the ones that are mourning.
I'm learning to pray for my enemies. The scary part is I don't know who my enemy is. Because I have people who come here and pick up a sign, but yet will hold a camera when they see something happening. I'm tired of that. I'm tired of that it's okay for us to keep pressing likes on pictures and videos.
I wouldn't say that I was arrogant in leaping into 40 days, but perhaps a little bit irreverent in what that would mean spiritually and the toll that would take. Feeling is like, man, maybe this was a mistake.
In the beginning especially, it didn't feel as if enough people were showing up to this space to bring the spiritual into our physical fight for racial justice.
And I gotta say, I don't wanna come out today. I'm tired.
What kept me going throughout the 40 days was my own personal, private spiritual practice. I continued to go even on those hard days because I've learned the power of ritual every day, day in and day out.
What pieces of this racist system are we crying out to the heavens to bring an end to?
I don't know what anyone here believes in, but...
Defending those kids? Now who we're defending? The kids?
You know, preach...
Another little kids shot.
Find higher
guys
power.
You guys want to be important? Want to be important?
Find higher
married,
power.
I would love to sit down and ask you, what's your name? Hi, David. My name is Nate Shaw. I'm getting my exercise.
No unity with the peaceful protesters. How can't ride a fight peacefully?
Are you being peaceful? Are you being peaceful?
My neighborhood.
Our neighborhood too!
We
have a boy too!
Little kids getting shot tonight don't have a choice!
This is my neighborhood!
Yes, that was mine! My neighborhood too! I got the right to be here!
Put your bikes down! If you have time to stop and walk to school,
on the police!
Look at all the people watching! Look at them!
They ain't doing nothing!
I've been out here every single night!
Can't call the police!
We're out here mourning Black lives! And this clown can't even let us mourn! What are you talking about? You're here killing
what? What about that?
I'm about to lose my mind! I'm about to lose my mind!
We can't even gather and mourn?
Every day we come here and we just scream in the sky! Because there's nothing left to say! There's nothing left to say!
Children, what about the children?
We didn't go a week, it felt like, without there being an incident.
People are fucking stupid as hell. You don't know what happened.
Someone resisting, even us trying to come together as a community and mourn. We put that heckling experience online. And so because of us putting out that video, we had 50, 60, 70 people coming out daily. In many ways, I wish it didn't take for that.
How I found out about the action, I was by the park that Sunday evening sitting down, and I saw what was going on, and I just decided to be a part of it. I just walk over, take up a sign, and...
Just yesterday, my brother Emerson happened upon us and shared about
You have never heard about some people who were murdered by the police and all these stuff, because like for my cousin last year, it was like, because it's in Delaware and it's like a small area and they don't have body cam and all of these stuff. Enough people didn't know about it.
His name is Ricardo Hilton. He's a Jew of color. He's a Black Jew. So many Black people are murdered on the regular that we only hearing about it today.
Ricardo was more like a brother to me. We grew up in Jamaica together. The first time when I said his name in the circle,
It was like a burden lift off my head. This protest has given me more hope. Other protests, I would go out. It would be like we just march over the Brooklyn Bridge, chant Black Lives Matter. But this one was more like a spiritual connection.
It's been really igniting more hope in my heart of my place within the Jewish community that I walked away from for most of my life because I felt so othered, because I didn't see anyone that looked like me.
It was actually the first protest that I went to that we circled up, us facing one another. This is a level of vulnerability that I'm just not quite used to seeing in an action. And then realize that was the whole point.
Any other additional pieces of warning or confessions before we turn east and cry out to the heavens?
Name it. What it is that you did wrong. It does something to our psyche.
I don't think I realized what I would be confessing to. I don't think I even realized in the beginning that I would be confessing anything. Ways that I culturally appropriate in my day-to-day life, ways in my job that I stay silent. We were called to confess really specific things. I think that's what was really hard.
As an event producer in the city, there were many times in which I invited a Black or Indigenous person of color to present or share work as an artist. And I was more interested in appearing to outsiders that I was doing the right thing, and that I was inviting diversity, than I was actually who that person was and what their art was about.
Honestly, the stake is Amy Cooper. Who knows what she knew intellectually? Who knows what she understood about systemic racism? But in that moment, when she got into fight or flight mode, she went back into her core biases, her core racism. And in that moment, making that decision, she jeopardized the life of a Black man. If we can't get into our bodies in the ways whiteness shows up for us as white Jews, and the ways in which we've internalized white supremacy, we will continue to enact violence and trauma and death upon Black people in the United States.
Okay. Never thought we'd make it to this moment. It's crazy to reflect that this is the end of week 6, you know, from when we started this.
This has been going on from the time the temple was destroyed.
Hold on. But it didn't start with George Floyd. It didn't start with Eric Garner.
Right.
It didn't start with Mike Brown.
It didn't start with George Floyd. It didn't start with Eric Garner.
I know that's right.
It didn't start with Mike Brown.
Say it.
It didn't even start with the transatlantic slave trade.
Hello.
It started with us turning away from Hashem, turning away from Torah, turning away from justice, and embracing baseless hatred instead.
I know that's right.
The prophet Yirmiyahu lived at the time of the destruction of the first temple, and he wrote the book we're about to read, we're about to chant, the book of Eicha. The word Eicha means how. How?
Eicha yashvav adon, odeinu tiflena heinenu, elizrateinu
avata. Adonai Le'olam Teshev Kisacha.
This destruction that we mourn today was prophesied. And tonight we have a challenge. We have a challenge to make a new self-fulfilling prophecy in our hearts and in our families' hearts, to make a society that prophesizes that when a young Black man walks by you, that he deserves trust,
that he deserves the benefit of the doubt, and that he deserves forgiveness when he makes mistakes.
Ricardo Henry Hilton.
Ricardo Henry Hilton.
Leilene Extravaganza.
This Tisha B'Av service was different, and I think it left some people confused, because it explicitly links Tisha B'Av with the destruction of black and brown people.
Tony McDade.
David McAtee.
David McAtee.
George Floyd.
George Floyd.
Majesty of the universe, who has consecrated us with your commandments and commanded us to occupy ourselves with the needs of the community.
It was important to us that folks understood that the spiritual grounding is for the sake of our lived experiences in this world.
Welcome to the last day of 40 days of Teshuvah. For the last 38, 39 days, we've gathered here to bring the physical fight for racial justice to meet the spiritual, creating that space of mourning. Tonight, we're moving from just that space of mourning to also incorporating a space of action.
We ended the 40 days with a teach-in on the BREATHE Act. The vision that black organizers around this country had articulated for what it will take on a policy level for us to be able to breathe.
Under education, the first section. We know that in New York, 8 out of 10 black and brown New Yorkers go to school in a school that has been systematically underfunded. It calls for removing cops from our schools. It calls for curriculum that teaches about the history of colonization and slavery.
Yeah. So today, the BREATHE Act is our modern-day Civil Rights Act. It's basically redefining what community safety looks like, right?
We're gonna need the BREATHE Act and many other levels of systemic change to actually create the world of justice that we seek.
I don't want to say that I believe that the BREATHE Act is the cornerstone to our mass liberation.
Say it again!
I don't want to say that the BREATHE Act is the cornerstone to our mass liberation.
But what I do want to say is that we are.
As we near the end of this fast, mourning the destruction of black communities and black lives, we're gonna lift up our voices and cry out to the heavens for one last time.
What is your deepest desire for what you want to grow out of this?
I think my deepest desire and hopes of what could come from this is a much more publicly acknowledged movement to seek the spiritual and to validate the essential nature of bringing the physical fight for black lives and racial justice to the spiritual, and that our own devices are not enough. And right now, that still feels very fringe. Something that's nice, but just nice. That's, you know, a nice thing to do, but not essential. Not a key part of our strategy of how we're gonna actually create change. How black lives will actually start mattering in this country.
I believe
that we will win.
I believe that we will win.
I.